just 4 years, MK had tattooed itself onto the arm of gaming culture. It was ready, or so Midway thought, to step outside the genre and go on an adventure. Mortal Kombat Mythology Sub-Zero followed the original Icebreaker in a side-scrolling mission to defeat Quan Chi before he tried to steal an amulet from the elder god Shinnok.
No! The amulet! No!
The controls weren't a stretch from the MK tried and true, and it focused on a big name most every fan adored, but the first chapter of this series became a myth in itself. Its October release in 1997 was immediately overshadowed by a much more highly anticipated arrival.
Finish him!
MK4 marked Combat's 3D debut, albeit a truncated one. Determined to return the series to its darker roots, the gameplay felt very similar to past titles, though without the previously inconsequential frivolities. MK also introduced the use of weapons and certain environmental hazards, such as rocks to throw at enemies. You could now sidestep during battle, ducking in and out of the new 3D environments, and a max damage meter prevented unnecessarily long combos. MK4 reintroduced Shinnok, the Elder God, one of the controllers of the six realms within the Mortal Kombat universe. Banished to the Netherrealm for an unaccountable number of years, he predictably escaped and threatened all worlds. Raiden called upon newly drafted Earthrealm warriors Fujin, the Wind God, Jarek, a member of the Black Dragon, Kai, another Shaolin monk, Riko, Shinnok's general, and Tanya, a traitor to Adenia. Mortal Kombat 4 had a lengthy and difficult production process, mainly due to the sheer size of the development team. However, because actors were no longer needed for motion capture, animating anything became substantially easier. MK4 also utilized multiple camera angles for some of the more grotesque show-and-tells. Port-wise, MK4 invaded the Nintendo 64, PlayStation, and the PC. A Sega Dreamcast version of MK4 dubbed Gold was pressed and stamped in 1999. Gold had all the makings of MK4, and like Ultimate 3, it enticed with exclusive readmitted characters and stages. Extras aside, it would be 5 long years until MK5, the longest between major story-driven installments. Jax bravely tried to pass the time in 2000 with Special Forces for the PlayStation. With no original developers involved, there was no one to give it care and credibility. The top-down first-person spy adventure starred the bio-agent and his gang, the Black Dragon, in a daring yet conventional prison break. It was not the series at its finest. Mortal Kombat's true emergence in 3D didn't occur until Mortal Kombat Deadly Alliance. On the brink of overexposure, the gap between big entries provided a nice buffer, allowing the series to breathe. Released only on home consoles in 2002, DA painted a disturbing scene by immediately killing off Liu Kang. The sorcerers Quan Chi and Shang Tsung, having formed an alliance, also managed to off Shao Kahn. This was all portrayed as being fictional within the Mortal Kombat universe, so Deadly Alliance brought back a lot of revered veterans. New to the rabble were the blind swordsman Kenshi, a drunken master Boraicho, an outworld warrior Li Mei, a Lin Kuei apprentice Frost, and Red Dragon agents Su Hao and Movado. Considered a gameplay reboot, each character now came equipped with a series of fighting stances you could switch in and out of. The ability to run was dropped, and each warrior had fewer special moves. This was done so that players would take advantage of each character's individual fighting mechanics, since they all grew to now differ greatly from one another. The full 3D stages allowed freedom to move anywhere within the arena. Standing out amidst the various tests of might was Conquest, a half-tutorial, half-adventure mode. It fleshed out the story and provided connections between characters wherever possible. By playing through the game's modes, players earned coins that they could spend on various items in the crypt. The only thing missing were stage fatalities, possibly dropped in the midst of all the wacky distractions. Following a failed animated series, live-action series, and subpar film sequel, the Mortal Kombat brand was losing stamina. This new alliance brought MK from digitization to realization. It made $2 million. Ushering in a sixth tournament. In 2004, the Xbox and PlayStation 2 played host to the next installment of Mortal Kombat, Deception. The GameCube version wasn't released until 2005, though it included both Shao Kahn and Goro as exclusive fighters. Deception introduced a new boss, Onaga, the long-forgotten Dragon King, who could only be stopped by destroying six artifacts from which he drew his power. Deception turned Conquest Mode into a full-fledged action RPG that encouraged exploration. Players assumed the role of Shujinko, a monk sent out on the original realm-bending, artifact-retrieving quest.
The gods take a dim view of senseless violence.
Mortal Kombat Deception featured 26 fighters and borrowed the engine of Deadly Alliance. Only 9 entries were brand new to the MK universe. Each character maintained 2 stances, 2 fatalities, and a weapon. Some stages also came equipped with an even better weapon that players could grab on the fly. Harakiri, a new way to voluntarily end the fight, let you deny your opponent the gratifying mockery of your death. Chess combat played just as rigidly and gruesomely as it sounds, and puzzle combat took Street Fighter's cue that there are no two genres that shouldn't be combined at least twice.
Finish her! Sub-Zero wins.
For MK to preserve its legacy, Deception needed to be a flawless victory. It sold 1 million units, becoming the fastest-selling midway product of its day. It walked away with Fighting Game of the Year at the 8th Annual Interactive Achievement Awards. In 2006, it was ported to the PSP as Unchained, developed by Just Games Interactive. Blaze, Frost, Jax, and Kitana snuck into the portable roster, though with only one fatality apiece and no Harakiri. The franchise that a decade earlier was almost banned in some countries was now recognized as the finest in its genre. The money and credibility poured back in. Maybe this time, an adventure game would work. Mortal Kombat Shaolin Monks was released on September 16, 2005. It told an alternate version of the events surrounding the aftermath of the first tournament. Shang Tsung, with Goro's aid, retreated to Outworld, leaving Liu Kang and Kung Lao to fend for themselves. The gameplay was fast, frantic, and much more evocative of the series' strengths than either mythologies or special forces. The multi-directional combat system let you pick apart multiple enemies at once, and linear levels encouraged fighters to utilize the environment when completing a kill. With a hefty combo system in tow, players could also build up a fatality meter and unleash their finisher of choice. Shaolin Monks helped enforce a policy Midway had been working toward for a long time: deliver a new game in the MK universe every year. Shaolin Monks sold over 1 million copies and holds a sacred spot in the franchise for most fans. But in the 6 years following, Mortal Kombat failed to produce a similar game. Little did MK's crazy cast know, their tournament was about to meet its end.
The critical point has finally been reached.
The 7th MK, appropriately titled Armageddon, began the series' first chaotic conclusion in October of 2006. Armageddon was the final chapter, meant to be a send-off for any and all of the characters that have ever been initiated. The bulky roster flared to 64 fighters, making Armageddon the biggest and most substantial of any other MK title to date. And for the first time, players could design their own character with a wide range of tools. Each fighter only possessed 2 fighting stances, and due to the immense size of the cast, Armageddon ditched character-specific fatalities in lieu of a creative fatality feature.
Finish her! Cage wins. Mortal Fatality.
In Armageddon's reintroduced Conquest Mode, players assumed the role of Tavin, one of 2 brothers put in suspended animation because of future events witnessed by their parents. It smartly borrowed elements from Shaolin Monks, giving Tavin a chance to wield weapons, and the mode got much better marks than its 2 predecessors. The other non-traditional entry was Motor Combat, a light but nonetheless hysterical trip around the track, complete with custom hazards and personalized vehicles. Armageddon was highly praised for its extras and insane character count, but with bland fatalities, once the game was left to the fighting, it was clear the 3D engine was becoming as ancient as the gods that watched over this hallowed competition. MK's future was again in question.
The battle for survival begins.
Engage.
Japan saw the start of something special in 1996 when Capcom decided to pit select Street Fighters to battle some of the boldest faces throughout the canon of Marvel Comics. By the turn of the century, this collaborative series spread past arcades to the PS1, PS2, Saturn, and the Dreamcast. Fans had to test their patience for a decade longer to get a fourth, and while the boards and forums were screaming about this, the obvious counterbalance to this splashy sprite fest was beginning to take shape. If there's any League of Warriors that understands split timelines and unexplained plot portals, it's DC. Mortal Kombat vs. DC Universe, technically MK8, was originally supposed to be similar to the recent mass reboot. But in April of 2008, it was announced that MK would take on DC Comics legend by legend. Borrowing the Unreal Engine and teaming up with Warner Brothers Interactive, Midway made a play that was predictable, but silly and satisfying at the same time. 11 heroes and villains from each side of the dimensional tear stepped forward. Characters like Darkseid and the Joker seemed like a perfect fit for MK's messy way of doing things, but despite early gameplay teases, the fatalities were tuned down for the little ones who just wanted to play as Superman.
Superman wins. Heroic brutality.
Eye-catching cinemas and two zany storylines helped save the day, raising console sales to just shy of 2 million copies. It not only made MK look good, DC Universe was one of the best-selling games in Midway's history. Mortal Kombat had lasted for 16 years because Ed Boon and his minions always kept their fan base surprised. But after a big-budget crossover deal and loads of button-mashing minigames, dumping more features on the pile didn't seem like the way to keep MK fresh. So Midway, or Raiden, depending on who you trust more, made the wise decision to give it all up. By going back in time, the series erased all expectations and rewrote their own rulebook. Mortal Kombat was a killer fighting series once again. Its future looked delightfully dark.
Scorpion wins. Fatality.
Ask any MK maniac why they love Midway's masterpieces of mutilation, and they'll say the proof is in the punishment. As much as the hallmarks of this industry encourage innovation and push the limits of known science, we need a certain manner of tastelessness to maintain balance in all worlds of gaming. It may poke fun with its fatalities, but Ed Boon and Midway have always remained deadly serious when it came to Mortal Kombat. They'll go to almost any length to bring their faithful tournament tiers the spectacle they demand, whether that extends to the small set, the silver screen, or a whole new generation of fighters waiting to be tested.
Finish him.
Victory.